I miss my friend Barry. Barry's not dead. He just lives in New Jersey, which I realize some folks think is practically being dead. But I lived there for 10 years myself and found that I really loved the place. Such a wonderful mix of seaside beaches, fields of corn and tomatoes, alongside of the excitement of city life. But I'm not here to do a Chamber of Commerce pitch for the Garden State. Rather, I'm here to tell you about my relationship with Barry. Did you ever have a friend with whom you really didn't have a lot in common, yet you hit it off beautifully? Barry and I are like that. I'm a pastor. I've devoted my life to matters of faith and religion. Barry, while certainly respectful of religion, is not at all what one would call religious. Barry is an accountant, and a darn good one at that. I, though currently serving as treasurer of my Rotary Club, am less than enamored with facts and figures and numbers. I love baseball and the Red Sox. Barry is a football fan and follows the Green Bay Packers. Barry met his wife while they were still kids, started dating the freshman year of high school. Linda and I met after we were adults and both had children of our own. I ride a bike. Barry lifts weights. He's politically conservative, and I'm decidedly not. I read the New York Times. Barry reads the Wall Street Journal. You would think with all those disparities, we would have a very hard time connecting. But the truth is, some of the deepest and most meaningful conversations I've ever had have been those I've had with Barry. What's the old saying? Steel sharpens steel. The secret, I think, is that we both have a very deep and abiding respect for each other. And we both understand that the other has a well thought out and very caring point of view. Both Barry and I long for the day when the world is set right. We just see different paths for getting there. Barry and I used to go out frequently for dinner with our wives. Sometimes we partied with other couples as well. But the times when our conversation was the most rich were the long, dark nights we shared hosting the homeless. The church I served in New Jersey was part of a coalition of faith communities. A coalition that provided emergency shelter for homeless men and women. The hosting congregation would provide space for cots, a hot dinner, a hot breakfast, a bag lunch to go, and two volunteers to stay overnight and supervise things. A recliner was provided for the volunteers, who could take turns sleeping if they wanted. But usually both Barry and I stayed up most of the night talking about everything and anything. Politics, religion, politics, social issues, politics, sports. When I'd come home in the morning, Linda would ask if the two of us had managed to solve the world's problems overnight. We usually hadn't, but we gave it an awfully good try. As the nights would wear on, our conversation would begin to slow down a bit as fatigue set in. But gradually we would notice out the kitchen windows in that church basement, the darkness beginning to fade, And then to the east, the light would begin to grow brighter and brighter as the sun would begin to rise. When we finally dismissed those in our care and went up the steps and outside, depending on the time of year, it was not unusual for us to be greeted by the pinks and golds of dawn. It wasn't a sunrise off of Sanibel, but in its own Jersey sort of way, it was a thing of beauty. And for the two of us, a symbol of hope. For Barry and I both held in our hearts hope that the homeless people we had met and gotten to know a bit overnight would have a brighter day than the one they'd had before. Maybe someone would find a job or permanent housing or be reconciled with a family member. Henry David Thoreau once said, "We must learn to keep ourselves awake, not by mechanical aids, but by an infinite expectation of dawn." An infinite expectation of dawn. That's what kept Barry and I awake. That's what kept us going those long, dark Jersey nights. Hope. Hope for the future. And an infinite expectation of the dawn. For Barry and I both believe, each in our own way, that God can and will work to bring about a better world. Despite our dramatic differences, Barry and I both believe that the dawn will come. Our reading from Matthew, a traditional first Sunday in Advent passage, is all about having an infinite expectation of dawn. It is drawn from a longer section in Matthew, sometimes called the Little Apocalypse. It is all about the end of time and the second coming. While our hearts and minds have already turned towards Christmas, while we already are focusing on the annual celebration of the birth of Jesus, the first coming, if you will, this passage points not to an event in the past, but rather an event in the future. For those of us who are theologically liberal or even moderate, this passage and the surrounding materials may feel very uncomfortable. Unlike our more theologically conservative brothers and sisters, we aren't quite sure what to do with this talk of apocalypse, the rapture, the second coming. As one commentator writes, one need not lean very far to the theological left to be prone to dismiss this line of thinking as somewhere way out there to the right. But even if we dismiss this traditional imagery of a triumphant Jesus arriving on a white stallion breaking through the clouds to gather up the faithful to heaven, even if we reject that as mere metaphor, even if we are disinclined to take it literally, which I am, we are wise to avoid throwing out the baby with the bathwater. And while it may be mere metaphor, it does hold for us powerful reminders. Indeed, these ancient adages and age-old warnings should give us pause to think not so much about the future, but more importantly, perhaps, about the here and now. When Barry and I were watching out for our homeless guests, we knew when the sun was going to come up. But, says Jesus in today's reading, no one knows when the second coming will occur. You can't look it up in the old farmer's almanac. You can't find it online. Well, no, that's not true. There are some folks online who claim to know when it's going to happen. But the reality is, but about that day and hour, Jesus says, no one knows. Neither the angels in heaven, nor, referring to himself, the Son, but only the Father, only God. Jesus then goes on to remind his listeners how most folks in Noah's day were surprised by the flood. The second coming will be like that, he says, sudden and swift. Folks will be going about their everyday activities, he says. Farmers will be in the field. Homemakers will be fixing dinner. Accountants will be toting up figures. Preachers will be teaching classes. That's when it will happen. Right in the midst of the everyday. So, he says, keep awake. Keep alert. Have an infinite expectation of the dawn. You never know, says Jesus, when I'm going to show up. After all, I fooled folks the first time. Who would have guessed that a peasant child born in a stable would grow up to be the promised Messiah? Who would have thought that a homeless, wandering rabbi would be the promised one? You see, you don't have to take this passage and the surrounding material in Matthew literally to heed the warning. Jesus may show up anywhere at any time, and those who are wise will keep awake. It's not so much about the second coming in some apocalyptic fashion as it is about the second and third and fourth and fifth coming in everyday life. It is about the fact that Jesus comes to us again and again and again and again, and most often in very unexpected ways, at unexpected times, in unexpected places. I served that church in New Jersey where Barry and I hosted the homeless back in the 90s. It was a time of great fear and confusion around HIV/AIDS. And most of you were alive at that time, and you know what I'm talking about. People went out of their way to avoid people with AIDS. I had a good friend who was evicted from his apartment for no other reason than that he had contracted the syndrome. It was like a modern-day version of leprosy. On this World AIDS Day, much progress has been made in terms of treatment and in terms of public education. But back then, an AIDS diagnosis was a virtual death sentence. Indeed, in some parts of the world where drugs are not readily available, it still is a death sentence. John Michael Oxley lived in San Francisco back then, one of the epicenters of the epidemic. He was working with a ministry called Project Open Hand. I've done a bit of volunteer work with the organization myself. Among other things, it provides meals on wheels for AIDS patients living at home. In an article Oxley wrote for his church newsletter, he described some of his experience. One of the patients he delivered meals to was a young Hispanic man. The first time Oxley delivered meals to him, he flinched when the young man opened the door to his apartment. He writes, "He was a young man, but he looked so very old. His face was completely covered with lesions." The patient was so weak that he couldn't even carry his meal back into his apartment. So Oxley took it into the kitchen for him, put it on the table. He said, "God bless," and then he let himself out. "I scurried down the hall," he writes, "went around the corner and fell against the wall and wept. It hurt too much, this delivering meals. I was tired of seeing young, lesioned, old men." Later that night, though, it occurred to him. His Hispanic patient was named Jesus, Jesus. And I realized then that when I brought the bag lunch and the hot dinner to these guys, I was actually bringing a meal to Jesus. For he had shown up again in the most unexpected of places. It was for Oxley like the second coming, or the third, or the fourth or fifth. After all, didn't Jesus say, "Just as you do it for one of these, the least of my brothers and sisters, so you do it for me"? Would I be able to deal with this terrible illness every Saturday, Oxley wonders in the article. "Sure," he responds, "certainly. How often do you get to see the faces of Jesus staring at you out of their doorways?" He titled the article, "Jesus Has AIDS and Lives on Valencia Street." "Keep awake," says Jesus. "Keep alert. You never know when I might show up. Live in an infinite expectation of the dawn. And while you are waiting, while you are watching, tend to the needs of those around you, your family, your friends, and those you don't even know. The Hispanic guy who trims your palm trees, the clerk at Bailey's or Jerry's, the hard-working single mom waitress who can't wait to get home to her children, the homeless, the sick, the outcasts of society. Barry and I never solved the world's problems in those long nighttime conversations. But I like to think, and I think he does too, that by tending to the needs of our brothers and sisters, we may have helped bring a bit of dawn into the darkness. And while we never saw Jesus mounted on a white stallion breaking through the clouds, Jesus showed up every time we opened the church doors and set up those cots, even as he showed up at the doorway of an apartment on Valencia Street. Keep awake, for you do not know the day your Lord is coming. Keep awake. Amen. On that night long ago, as those disciples gathered with Jesus around the Seder table, as they gathered there to share the Passover feast, they were no doubt exhausted, tired by a long week of excitement, of activity, of stress, of concern. Later that night, they would fall asleep while they were waiting. But at that meal, they stayed awake, awake long enough to hear words that they in turn passed on to us. As we gather at this table, as we remember that night, as we celebrate with these very common everyday elements, might we keep awake. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, we pray that you bless our time together around this table. We thank you for your presence made known in such common things as cup and loaf, and we pray that we be ever alert to your presence around us in the people and places we see and know. Gracious God, bless these elements and bless us as we receive them, and hear us as we share together those ancient words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
And so on that night, as they gathered for one last meal, Jesus took the bread. And as was the custom, he gave thanks and he broke it. And then he added these words, words for his disciples and all his followers to hold on to as they wait and to remind them to be awake. He said, "This is my body broken for you. As often as you do this in remembrance of me."
And then he took the cup traditionally set at the table for Elijah, the prophet who would come to foretell the coming of the Messiah, one for whom they waited. This cup, he said, this is the new covenant, the new promise, the new testament in my blood. As often as we eat of this cup and loaf, we do indeed remember. We do indeed make ready.
"Take and eat. This is the bread of life broken for you."
Drink of it with expectation in your hearts.
Let us pray. Holy One, we thank you for this chance to experience Christ's presence with us here in this meal, in each other, and in our world. Enable us to take what we have experienced here and share that love, grace, and reconciliation in each and every day of our lives. Amen.
Call religious. Barry is an accountant, and a darn good one at that. I, though currently serving as treasurer of my Rotary Club, am less than enamored with facts and figures and numbers. I love baseball and the Red Sox. Barry is a football fan and follows the Green Bay Packers. Barry met his wife while they were still kids, started dating the freshman year of high school. Linda and I met after we were adults and both had children of our own. I ride a bike. Barry lifts weights. He's politically conservative, and I'm decidedly not. I read the New York Times. Barry reads the Wall Street Journal. You would think with all those disparities, we would have a very hard time connecting. But the truth is, some of the deepest and most meaningful conversations I've ever had have been those I've had with Barry. What's the old saying? Steel sharpens steel. The secret, I think, is that we both have a very deep and abiding respect for each other. And we both understand that the other has a well-thought-out and very caring point of view. Both Barry and I long for the day when the world is set right. We just see different paths for getting there. Barry and I used to go out frequently for dinner with our wives. Sometimes we partied with other couples as well. But the times when our conversation was the most rich were the long, dark nights we shared hosting the homeless. The church I served in New Jersey was part of a coalition of faith communities, a coalition that provided emergency shelter for homeless men and women. The hosting congregation would provide space for cots, a hot dinner, a hot breakfast, a bag lunch to go, and two volunteers to stay overnight and supervise things. A recliner was provided for the volunteers, who could take turns sleeping if they wanted, but usually both Barry and I stayed up most of the night talking about everything and anything. Politics, religion, politics, social issues, politics, sports. When I'd come home in the morning, Linda would ask if the two of us had managed to solve the world's problems overnight. We usually hadn't, but we gave it an awfully good try. As the nights would wear on, our conversation would begin to slow down a bit as fatigue set in. But gradually we would notice out the kitchen windows in that church basement, the darkness beginning to fade. And then to the east, the light would begin to grow brighter and brighter as the sun would begin to rise. When we finally dismissed those in our care and went up the steps and outside, depending on the time of year, it was not unusual for us to be greeted by the pinks and golds of dawn. It wasn't a sunrise off of Sanibel, but in its own Jersey sort of way, it was a thing of beauty, and for the two of us, a symbol of hope. For Barry and I both held in our hearts hope that the homeless people we had met and gotten to know a bit overnight would have a brighter day than the one they'd had before. Maybe someone would find a job or permanent housing, or be reconciled with a family member. Henry David Thoreau once said, "We must learn to keep ourselves awake, not by mechanical aids, but by an infinite expectation of dawn. An infinite expectation of dawn. That's what kept Barry and I awake. That's what kept us going those long, dark Jersey nights. Hope. Hope for the future. And an infinite expectation of the dawn. For Barry and I both believe, each in our own way, that God can and will work to bring about a better world. Despite our dramatic differences, Barry and I both believe that the dawn will come. Our reading from Matthew, a traditional first Sunday in Advent passage, is all about having an infinite expectation of dawn. It is drawn from a longer section in Matthew, sometimes called the Little Apocalypse. It is all about the end of time and the second coming. While our hearts and minds have already turned towards Christmas, while we already are focusing on the annual celebration of the birth of Jesus, the first coming, if you will, this passage points not to an event in the past, but rather an event in the future. For those of us who are theologically liberal or even moderate, this passage and the surrounding materials may feel very uncomfortable. Unlike our more theologically conservative brothers and sisters, we aren't quite sure what to do with this talk of apocalypse, the rapture, the second coming. As one commentator writes, one need not lean very far to the theological left to be prone to dismiss this line of thinking as somewhere way out there to the right. But even if we dismiss this traditional imagery of a triumphant Jesus arriving on a white stallion, breaking through the clouds to gather up the faithful to heaven, even if we reject that as mere metaphor, even if we are disinclined to take it literally, which I am, we are wise to avoid throwing out the baby with the bathwater. And while it may be mere metaphor, it does hold for us powerful reminders. Indeed, these ancient adages and age-old warnings should give us pause to think not so much about the future, but more importantly, perhaps, about the here and now. When Barry and I were watching out for our homeless guests, we knew when the sun was going to come up. But, says Jesus in today's reading, no one knows when the second coming will occur. You can't look it up in the old farmer's almanac. You can't find it online. Well, no, that's not true. There are some folks online who claim to know when it's going to happen, but the reality is, but about that day and hour, Jesus says, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor, referring to himself, the Son, but only the Father, only God. Jesus then goes on to remind his listeners how most folks in Noah's day were surprised by the flood. The second coming will be like that, he says, sudden and swift. Folks will be going about their everyday activities, he says. Farmers will be in the field. Homemakers will be fixing dinner. Accountants will be toting up figures. Preachers will be teaching classes. That's when it will happen. right in the midst of the everyday. So, he says, keep awake, keep alert, have an infinite expectation of the dawn. You never know, says Jesus, when I'm going to show up. After all, I fooled folks the first time. Who would have guessed that a peasant child born in a stable would grow up to be the promised Messiah? Who would have thought that a homeless wandering rabbi would be the promised one? You see, you don't have to take this passage and the surrounding material in Matthew literally to heed the warning. Jesus may show up anywhere at any time, and those who are wise will keep awake. It's not so much about the second coming in some apocalyptic fashion as it is about the second and third and fourth and fifth coming in everyday life. It is about the fact that Jesus comes to us again and again and again and again, and most often in very unexpected ways, at unexpected times, in unexpected places. I served that church in New Jersey where Barry and I hosted the homeless back in the 90s. It was a time of great fear and confusion around HIV/AIDS. And most of you were alive at that time, and you know what I'm talking about. People went out of their way to avoid people with AIDS. I had a good friend who was evicted from his apartment for no other reason than that he had contracted the syndrome. It was like a modern-day version of leprosy. On this World AIDS Day, much progress has been made in terms of treatment and in terms of public education. But back then, an AIDS diagnosis was a virtual death sentence. Indeed, in some parts of the world where drugs are not readily available, it still is a death sentence. John Michael Oxley lived in San Francisco back then, one of the epicenters of the epidemic. He was working with a ministry called Project Open Hand. I've done a bit of volunteer work with the organization myself. Among other things, it provides meals on wheels for AIDS patients living at home. In an article Oxley wrote for his church newsletter, he described some of his experience. One of the patients he delivered meals to was a young Hispanic man. The first time Oxley delivered meals to him, he flinched when the young man opened the door to his apartment. He writes, "He was a young man, but he looked so very old. His face was completely covered with lesions." The patient was so weak that he couldn't even carry his meal back into his apartment. So Oxley took it into the kitchen for him, put it on the table. He said, "God bless," and then he let himself out. "I scurried down the hall," he writes, "went around the corner and fell against the wall and wept. It hurt too much, this delivering meals. I was tired of seeing young, lesioned, old men." Later that night, though, it occurred to him. His Hispanic patient was named Jesus, Jesus. And I realized then that when I brought the bag lunch and the hot dinner to these guys, I was actually bringing a meal to Jesus. For he had shown up again in the most unexpected of places. It was for Oxley like the second coming, or the third, or the fourth, or fifth. After all, didn't Jesus say, just as you do it for one of these, the least of my brothers and sisters, so you do it for me. Would I be able to deal with this terrible illness every Saturday, Oxley wonders in the article. Sure, he responds, certainly. How often do you get to see the faces of Jesus staring at you out of their doorways? He titled the article, Jesus Has AIDS and Lives on Valencia Street. Keep awake, says Jesus. Keep alert. You never know when I might show up. Live in an infinite expectation of the dawn. And while you are waiting, while you are watching, tend to the needs of those around you, your family, your friends, and those you don't even know. The Hispanic guy who trims your palm trees, the clerk at Bailey's or Jerry's, the hard-working single mom waitress who can't wait to get home to her children, the homeless, the sick, the outcasts of society. Barry and I never solved the world's problems in those long nighttime conversations. But I like to think, and I think he does too, that by tending to the needs of our brothers and sisters, we may have helped bring a bit of dawn into the darkness. And while we never saw Jesus mounted on a white stallion breaking through the clouds, Jesus showed up every time we opened the church doors and set up those cots, even as he showed up at the doorway of an apartment on Valencia Street. Keep awake, for you do not know the day your Lord is coming. Keep awake. Amen.